It is my distinct pleasure to introduce Sanjeev Arora, who is professor at computer science at Princeton. And well, the guys here know, but the guys maybe in biology don't know. He's quite a superstar, so you guys get quite a treat. Some of the most fundamental results in computer science in the last 20 years came from Sanjeev. But today he's going to talk for non-computer scientists, and I was really happy to find out that Sanjeev teaches a course on computer science for non-computer scientists in Princeton, so it's perfect.
Okay, thanks, Tanya. So, what's the preferred? I sit or stand? Can you see me if I stand? Or?
Yeah, I think you can sit.
You can
sit. Okay.
Yeah, we're actually going to mute our side so we don't get distracted, but we're here.
And the other thing is, at some point, I'll do like show and tell kind of thing, meaning, you know, participation kind of thing. What's a good place to do it with the camera?
The camera's right there. So you can see us. We're the lower panel and the upper panel.
See.
No, can you see?
Right. There. I see. So, we'll do that.
Well,
okay.
There is the computer scientist. On this side, there are computer scientists. So we're actually kind of keeping an eye, but we're going to work on the,
Okay. So, I teach this course called the Computational Universe, which is geared towards CS non-majors, especially people in social sciences and humanities. And so I just wanted to double check, how many of you have done any computer programming? Wait, everybody's done computer programming. Tanya?
Yeah.
Did you hear that?
I write basic in fourth grade, so I'm the old-fashioned.
All of these people are programmers.
Well, we all can write code. We all can write code, but I use Fortran Basic. What do you guys do?
R is not. Okay, well, maybe that's good. So I just wanted to...
So you can speak really fast then.
Okay. So I was expecting a somewhat different crowd. So I guess we'll see, okay? Maybe I'll be done now. Okay. All right, so telling a computer how to behave via pseudocode, which is a workaround for computing's tower of Babel. You see always things like this, you know, getting all thanks to Arthur for love, online matchmaking. And the keyword here is algorithms. You know, more kind of a joke page from Google. This was on their, on April 1st, you know, they had
April Fools, okay, yeah.
Google has this tradition, and one year they had, soulmate search on Google. And again, it says here that your life-altering search results are pretty solely with computer algorithms, without human intervention. So I wanted to give you some idea of what are computer algorithms, and how do you describe that? So a computer algorithm is a way to describe a computational task. Somebody who's never done it, and you have to do it in a precise way. Okay. And so, suppose you're trying to describe this task to somebody who's never done this, adding two numbers. How would you describe it? Not two single digit numbers. 7 million divided by 7,000.
So we add a column, it's greater than 10, carry that
to
the next column.
Oh, I'm going to multiplication. Oh, I said added. Sorry.
Yeah.
So you add a
sequence like that.
Okay.
Start at the right.
Okay. All right. Okay, great. So, Tanya, we're going to go through this very, very fast, I think, because everybody here is done the program. Okay, so, how can we describe an algorithm precisely enough so that there's no ambiguity? So, our method is pseudocode. Pseudocode illustrates essential features of all computer languages, you've heard of those computer languages, these are some common ones. I got it right, most of you have not programmed in any computer. You've got a bit of C, okay. MATLAB and R probably don't count as programming languages. Maybe they have enough features in MATLAB to make
it. It has the same logic. Else fall through and go on, so it's the same.
Right, so I guess it is a general purpose language. Features of human languages are nouns, verbs, subjects, objects, etc. And linguists have discovered that there are similar linguistic structures in most of the languages that have developed independently around the world. And turns out that computer languages have all very similar features as well, which pseudocode will illustrate. And features of computer languages are variables, simple arithmetic instructions, conditional and loop state. That's basically it, and that's pseudocode. So we'll see some examples. So first, of course, you know that for a computer, everything's a number, just Bieber song or image or whatever. They're all sequences of numbers. For instance, the Justin Bieber song is just you take the electrical signals coming in from the microphone and then you sample it tens of thousands of times per second and record those numbers. So that's a sequence of numbers from an MP3 that constitutes an MP3. Okay, broadly speaking, there's some more detail. Similarly, in an image, you just store the color value of each pixel. So the general task faced by a computer, since everything is a number, is that you're given a sequence of numbers in memory, and your goal is to process these numbers to achieve a desired sequence of numbers as output. For instance, in case of Justin Bieber's song, the electrical signals that will then drive the headphones and reproduce the song. Okay, so the song is stored on the hard drive, and the processor will process these numbers and generate electrical signals that will drive the headphones. Or if it's generating some other representation like USB, it will generate a USB signal which will go somewhere else. Okay, so just to see how that is done, so these slides are from my course where we talk about robots. So that's why the first two lectures are about robots, so that's why I'm phrasing this problem in terms of a robot. Our robot is getting ready for a big day, and he's actually a cheap guy. He wants to identify the cheapest model of human. Assuming you can scan the prices. So here's the example. So
I put it on the back of her computer or something, or that way they can see it.
We should probably.
Because you can put it here and.
Okay, let's put it on the table. They can see it from here.
And can you guys see?
Yeah.
Yeah, they can see. I mean, they may not see the numbers, but.
Two numbers at once?
Yeah. He can't do is imagine that this is a really long row of numbers. So you can't just say scan the whole thing and pick this one.
You have to understand why. So yeah. If then, like we talked about last time.
Okay, so
you had some discussion on programming.
Last night we were talking about mating system. I said, just like a computer program, if this, do this, if not, fall through, do that. If not fall through, do that. It's my old portrait.
So,
so tell the computer, start at the left.
Okay.
So, no, let's go. Okay. Let's do that. So,
and then I guess it's the next number.
There's a fundamental problem in your sequence of instructions, which makes it not conducive to process a large set of numbers.
Then speak if it's less than the one you have.
Okay, fine. So that was a not as major a point, but it was a bigger point.
Would it be faster to compare pairwise and like make a set of the smallest number and then compare pairwise that set?
No, that won't be any more efficient. But I'm talking about in terms of just the specification. So think of it this way. Suppose there were 1,000 numbers here. How many instructions would you have to give? Adam. To find the smallest. So
if
I can get
the one. Right. Slow, it's not efficient.
Right. So how can you describe just one, you can describe a method so that it works for 6 numbers, for 100 numbers, for 10,000 numbers. But you have to give some kind of a repeat instruction that does something over and over again. So not make a second attempt and tell them how to do it. So he has currently a number, so you're telling him start on the left?
Start with 22.
Yeah.
Okay.
So if any subsequent number is lower than that, switches
to the number currently. Good. Right. So that's right. So now we've got it. Okay. Thank you. So you have to do something like this, right? So pick up the first ball and check the price. And now you have that price memorized. Walk down the aisle for each ball and do this. If the price on the ball is less than the price in hand, exchange it with the one in hand. So you keep one ball always in your hand. Initially it's the one on to the left, further to the left. You walk down the aisle. And if you ever see a bottle with a lower price, then you swap. So now you have one liter. Okay? And so in 2 lines, you've described a procedure that works for 6 bottles and for 6 million. Okay? So this is, so all computer programs have this feature. Okay? That they work for an arbitrary input and an arbitrary number of arbitrary input size. And therefore, and it's the same program. So now, in a related setting where we're talking about pure programs, the robot has n prices stored in memory, so the robot is just programmed now and wants to find a minimum price. Okay, so now let's think about how you can write this program. So this previous program is written in English and you know, for a person, it's an ambiguous task, but we want to be really, really precise here because computers have really good time. So in order to discuss how you write this precise description, here's a simple slide of your memory. It's a scratch pad that can be perfectly erased and rewritten any number of times. So what you call variables or R or Pathlab or whatever. So variable is a piece of memory with a name, so it's a variable. Okay, so example, so in pseudocode you have instructions like this. The value 5 is assigned to the variable R. This left arrow is used in some languages, in other languages it might be equal or some other sign, but that's the assignment that you assign about the variable. All of you have seen this. I assign J, whatever value is currently, I and J are variables, whatever value I currently have, is assigned to J. And the important thing is that this leaves I unchanged. Okay, so it's a non-destructive call.
Yes.
Again, we all copy on USB stick and so obvious, although I remember that when I first learned the programming in 1980, we didn't have these things. It wasn't clear that a copy is non-destructive. If your value is from the end, maybe your value is now fine. Okay, so expression like assign the value of j plus 1 to I. So whatever is the value of j, you add 1 to it and assign that to I, and again leaves j unchanged.
But I increases that.
I becomes j plus 1.
Yeah. And if you're in a loop, then it just keeps adding. Because I is j.
Well, depending on
how you set it up, right?
Yeah. Now, the next line is the one that's, when you first see it, you do a double take, assign I plus 1 to I. So take the current value of I, add 1 to it, and assign it to I. That's new value. In some languages, instead of the left arrow, you have equal. Then you can do it through a double take. I equals I plus 1.
That's why.
What's that? Four characters. That's right, many languages, yeah.
Just redefines it.
Yeah.
Plus by one.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Arrays, this you all know from your math lab, an R is an array of values. You know, a table, we can go with a table. A, in square parentheses, I, is the I-th value of the array. Okay, so if you have an array with these stored numbers, A of 3, in the parentheses is the value in the third location, which is 52. Okay, so that's the way to access memory elements and do things with them. So the solution was to walk down the aisle for each one of this. So the pseudocode procedure for this is like this. You have n items stored in the array, so they have prices. And your pseudocode is a procedure find, which you call find min. It has two variables, I and best. Initially, best is 1, so that's the leftmost number, 1. The leftmost index, not the number is 22, the leftmost index, 1. And then you repeatedly do the following, do for I equals 2 to n. So what does it mean? So I is currently 1, okay? You say I from 2 to n. So 2 is this, 3, 4, 5, 6, okay? So if A of I, this number, is less than A of S, currently A of S, then you make that equal to I, okay? So now this was less than that, now S is 2.
That's when he put it on his shirt.
Yeah, that's when he put it on his shirt.
You substituted it for nothing, or the first one, you substituted it by putting it on your shirt. So you redefine best by this rule, less than the previous one. If it's true, put it on your shirt. You substitute it. If it's not true, you hold on to the old one. Best stays the same as your previous one, because the new one you sample is better than it, right? Do you understand?
Yeah, you've done some MATLAB and so on, so I think this is fairly funny. someone else. Okay. So this is the way, so now you see there's a 4-9 program that works for any number of prices n. Okay, and this n is going to be a parameter that will be set by the person running the program. Okay, and so you do it for
the old days, you had to set n before you started.
In Fortran, yeah, I think I never programmed it. Yeah.
But you had to set your memory, right? Memory was so costly, so you set your array size, your matrix size, and that's what you bought. You set your.
I see.
You had to define everything before you started.
I see.
Because you were dealing with.
Yeah. So, like when you run MATLAB, right, you can give it.
A compiler or something that's going to, that knows this language and yeah, operate on
it. Or you're calling this procedure, it's part of the library. And when you call it, you get it. So I have. Because we do only pseudocode in this class. We don't have it.
What is pseudocode? I mean, I don't know.
This is pseudocode.
It's code. It's the logic of it rather than the actual.
So it's pseudocode in the sense that.
If you put it in basic, it would be code.
This is more or less code, yeah.
So basically the compiler can recognize this language and it will operate on it.
That's right. You could write a compiler for this language. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, but
are
we
if you were to adapt a preset function to expand it, you would do it this way, whatever the rules were in language.
Except it's if and else
R. Okay, yeah, sorry. But in MATLAB and R, you define N. They want to know what N is and the rules they use for the statistics. Yeah. For the
anybody know wiki? Anything? Wiki administration.
Yeah.
You have to define it.
So you just say the length of the array.
Yes. You can do it N times. So you're going to do N looks, N comparisons.
Okay, so the advantage of doing pseudocode, why we teach pseudocode, is that when you're doing a concrete programming language, you know, you're sort of too much tied down, you know, how exactly are you calling,
and the convention.
And this is just sort of focusing on the meat of it, which is this. And other advantages that your students can write this, and if the meaning is quite clear, they get full points. Even if they forget a semicolon or whatever, or the computer program, it would, you know.
It crashes.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Here's another way to do it. So this is a do. So this is a do for loop. Okay. There's a do while loop, which is slightly different syntax. So. Sorry, yeah, it's a do while. So this is a loop which keeps executing while that condition is true. Okay, so I and n are, so best I and n are the variables. Well, n is set by what was calling the procedure. So initially I is 1, best is 1. Do while I, so again, it's going from left to right. So do while I is less than n, increment I becomes I plus 1. If a of I is less than a of best, then best becomes null.
Substitution just keeps doing.
It's the same thing, okay? I should show you the previous one. It's just, you know, here, when you have a do for loop, it's implicit that I gets incremented from 2, 3, 4, so on up to n. And here, you are sort of, you're implementing that yourself, okay? Using this conditional loop. So you're incrementing I yourself, and you repeat the loop so long as I say. Okay, so these are the two ways of writing loops. In a real programming language, there might be other ways, but these suffice for. Okay. In fact, actually, you don't need any loops at all. You can just do go-tos.
And those funny brackets that defines the entity.
The scope, yeah. The, this is those funny brackets. Are defining, it's called a compound statement. So these individual lines are simple statements, and then there's two curly braces. Curly braces are defining a compound statement, which is a bunch of code that is here. Let's look at other. So this is a, you know, this is a algorithm, right? So this is a task that does something, given some input, produces an output, namely the gross price, and it's unambiguously described. Okay, this is unambiguous. Whereas in English, you can argue whether or not it's unambiguous. This has really an unambiguous. Okay, so next problem for robot sorting. So now again, we have these numbers, and you have to arrange them so that prices increase from depth. So, robot again, or a new program?
Let's change roles. Let Catherine be the robot, and I don't be the robot.
Okay, good. All right. That's a good idea. From left to right. Yeah, but first actually just do it in English, you know. Just to remember that there was a...
Okay, if the next one is... The next one is less than what you're holding.
Set of comparisons.
Right. Set a different array. It's like I was ready. It's not the same.
So using your old algorithm. No worries.
Okay, now put it on, now pick it up and make it into a new array. Now do the same algorithm again. Put it in the next. Okay, so great, that works, but can you do it with just using one array? Do you really need two arrays?
The short answer is that actually both algorithms are fairly similar in efficiency.
Were they? Is there a more efficient way to do it?
There is a drastically more efficient way to do it called Quicksilver.
Can you tell us that?
Yeah, so let's do a randomized version of Quicksilver. Okay, let's do this one. Okay, let's just make sure that we understand. Okay, so the robot can think as well as that sort of bottle. This is the way Emma thought. Let me find the cheapest bottle and move it to the leftmost position. Then I only have to sort.
That was Emma.
Yeah. That was yours. And then I have to sort
the next slide. That was good. That's good.
To its right. Okay. So so this is and this, you know, it's completely clear that it works because, you know, whereas with yours, was might think a little. This is completely clear. You find the minimum, move it to the correct position, and now you're sorting the n minus 1 order. Completely clear that this works.
Well,
that's correct. So, okay, so the solution is you have to find the cheapest bottle among those numbered I to n. And this, so do for I equals 1 to n minus 1. Find the cheapest bottle among those numbered I to n. So when I is 1, you find the cheapest bottle in the entire bunch. Then you swap that bottle into the I's bottle, which is what we did. Move the cheapest one into the first position and move that one in the position where this was. And
so a swap is as efficient as putting in the new array and not reducing.
Yeah, so I mean, you could do a new array. These days, programming languages allow that, but you know,
the old days you could.
Yeah.
You bought space.
Yeah. You have to declare ahead of time. Okay, so all right. So we know how to do this. Okay, and this is very. I mean, you all done MATLAB, right? You all understand the benefits of having a library. So if you already defined a procedure for doing something, you want to use it again. And it's a fast one. Okay, this is called selection source. And another funny thing about this procedure is that we're defining what it means to sort n numbers, and we're defining it using sorting on n minus 1 numbers. Right? So the first line was using a procedure that we already defined. The second line is just, the two lines are finding the cheapest bottle and putting it there. And the remainder is just sorting the remaining n minus 1. So this is called a recursion, by the way. Your computational procedure is defined. But technically, we haven't defined it in a recursive fashion, but we could. This, by the way, is. Does anybody have this hot chocolate? Droste. It's the Dutch hot chocolate. Have you had it?
Yeah.
Very tasty. Anybody sees what's the recursion over there? Yeah. So there's a woman in traditional Dutch clothes.
Right, and there's the picture.
And she's holding the picture of the box, which of course has her picture on it. And in that picture, of course, you can see another box, which also has a picture.
Then after that,
all the way to
resolution.
At some point, you lose the resolution, but yeah, it's defining implicit recursion. In the US, the analog of this is the Land O'Lakes butter.
Or oh,
cinnamon point out to you and the recursion of what is
But Quaker Oats is the same way. Quaker Oats is the same way it's holding up the picture.
Quaker Oats, you're right.
Yeah,
a little
picture of the picture.
No, I mean, you didn't grow up in this country, so you're
in shock. I think what one you would have in England.
Right, yeah, Escher.
That's the main button.
We do it the same. Okay, so swapping. So we had on this, what you think, right? Basically, it was quite clear what it means to swap this. Okay? If these are two variables, x and y, how do you swap their values? Yes.
What's the pseudocode for swapping? Change this up. Could you change the subscript?
Sorry, there's no subscript here. These are just variables. Yeah.
But you had subscripts on that array. You had I.
Yeah, but these are just, I'm abstractly talking about two variables.
Yeah, good point.
Sorry? yeah, you guys have done programming, so you were very... Okay, you see why you need an extra variable?
Yeah. But why, how can you get in one? Because you can do it with just another two extra variables, which is five variables.
This one
here, this one here. Oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah, that was a great instruction. So you need an extra variable. All of you recognize that? Because if you assign y to x, then you've lost the value of x. Okay, so that's why you need to store it somewhere. And so you introduce a new variable, temp. You need to declare that in your program, and then this value. Okay, so all right. So that's how you would write that pseudocode. Okay, that swap the bottle. You have to have that kind of thing. So that was what happened here.
I don't know, you lost your computer. Did the cord come loose or something?
Yeah. I was, yeah.
You still have it on your screen.
But I didn't do anything.
No. Sanjeev, did you finish that presentation?
No, almost.
Right. Because it looks like it just your displays are not mirrored, so you have to move whatever it is to the other display, no?
Yeah. Trying to do that.
We just did swapping, so that's good. your program has vanished.
Sorry, trying again, okay?
Describe the dimension space that you need. Everything's done. Once you've defined it, then you set the initial conditions, which is what we just did here. We set y equals x and temp equals y. Mm-hmm. So you define your variables, you sandwich space that you take, you initialize it.
Explaining programming.
So you get an error when it reaches the last variable and tries to run the command. Like what you're telling him to compare.
So I just want to put it up again.
No, it won't have to be if you define it correctly. That's why it's the n minus 1. It doesn't have to do the n. You've lost the degree of freedom.
Okay.
Right, you don't do the next one. If you declare it to go too far, there's nothing there. It's going to be an error code. But it stops at n minus 1.
Okay.
So if you say the length of n has a number of elements in it, so it's...
I'm curious why we have such a big screen and we're not using it.
Okay. Good. Back.
What happened? Why did you lose it? Is it a mirror?
No, I get it.
You got it. Yeah, because it's a PowerPoint.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, you know.
Okay, that's very strange. I don't care. The last slide is.
Yeah, you lost. Oh, there you go. That's it. So now we have it.
Okay, so I want to answer your questions about the pseudocode again. Just to conclude at least that part of the presentation. Precise algorithm is a precise and ambiguous procedure for accomplishing a computational task. It's named for Abu Abdullah Muhammad bin Musa al-Khwarizmi, whose textbook on algebra named something algebra or something became algebra.
When did he live?
This was, I think, 7th century or 8th century. You know, in the golden age of... Examples, we talked about things like addition, long division, selection, so a lot of things that you learned in grade school arithmetic algorithms. and they taught you the procedure for
moving
for division or
yeah.
Yeah. Or the algorithms.
So memorization, long division.
Yeah, methods. They were called methods. Yeah, and those happen to be algorithms. But that's not the end of it. Those are the very simple algorithms. The world is very full of algorithms. All your apps have lots of algorithms. Okay, so it's a pseudocode. So working definition is that it's a pseudocode for transforming inputs to outputs. Okay, that's a working definition. Because pseudocode is unambiguous. So there were questions about the pseudocode. So was it here that you asked about, or the question?
Oh, Dan answered it.
Okay.
It was just how it dealt with calling the in command on the last one, but because it's the n minus one.
It's up to n minus one, not n. So you have to be careful. Those are a frequent
right.
cause of
yeah, I always crashing.
Okay.
They're fixable. That's all. Like, it doesn't compile. It just gives you an error. So you say, I know what it is. It didn't work.
No, you wouldn't cache this in compilation, would you?
What?
Would it?
I want to end. Draw on something that doesn't exist.
Yeah, but little n means
it will crash.
Might be hard to catch. Yes.
Number. Usually a warning line, the old
compiler. Little n is itself a variable or something. Yeah. But it tends to run hard. Okay, so we can take a few minutes break. I have a second part. I normally take a break. I think it's kind of hard for people to absorb after 15 minutes. So,
we can go. Just
want to
keep going.
All right, let's take a few minutes.
Well, I think people Kenya do jumping jacks at this point, or we'd sing a song. Okay? When the teacher sees the kids, she says, stand up. Run in place, and then sing the national anthem, or whatever.
So,
then she says,
yeah.
Quick
for that?
Yeah.
It's the one I looked at now.
I never learned it like this. I just learned it as they just forced us.
So I take.
Just do it.
Just do it. Yeah, we learned, you know, because I didn't. I learned computing purely. I learned statistics, and we did all the sums and squares by hand. Then we got calculators with that little red stuff, and from that moment on, we had to hand in our homework assignments with hand done sums and squares. We had to write code to do it. As well. So we learned computing with the Watt 4 compiler to learn how to run statistics. So we learned computing on the slide.
Yeah.
No logic of pseudocode or algorithms. We weren't told that. We just said,
yeah.
Here's your data string. This is how you do it. You have I's and J's, right? You pick your methods, you walk through.
Yeah, I mean, if you think
it's much more intuitive, this is much better for teaching students.
Yeah.
Logic of an algorithm, and we're not talking logic.
Yeah.
But
why do you want your own best?
Do it.
So this was a big debate within the university, you know, what kind of computing should students do, right? Because many application areas, people said, we would just talk like that, right? Why can't we just teach that, right? We teach them how to use packages.
It's not much better because you know it makes perfectly good sense to learn it in the general. And then you don't have to know about in a particular language.
Yeah.
But we didn't have a choice. It's Fortran. Then it became basic, which was easier. It was less constraining. I didn't have to declare as much.
But we said for random basic.
I still do. Yeah, I don't write much code anymore, but that's what I would do. But we learned, when I was a grad student, we learned PLC. Well, it was the IBM language, which sort of sits as the language that SAS uses. Okay, statistical batches uses. PL1, program language 1. Natural programming language PL1.
In RLP,
we it's basically a simpler version.
And then I can give you stuff from the IT and actually say like best people.
But we had to do everything with cards, and you had to go into the computer center and they'd give you cards. And you had to wait for your job to run, and it never ran. It came back.
Even in India, in mid-80s, we had
So you really tried to troubleshoot more than when I had my basic, I didn't worry about making mistakes because I always took it. If I waited an hour for the job to run and it failed, then I had gone until 2 in the morning and my wife would be very upset. And you had to go in and do everything. You had to go in and do the job. Your homework assignment was due next
week.
And there were no CAM programs for statistics, but there was time. We had to write regression, we had to write
She's going to the garage. Can I just make sure that I have a technique that I've done? Because if I start completely from scratch, surely if I find that it's best.
So this is the logic of your, this is your algorithm?
I'll do that within my code.
Compound instructions, if, then, else, loops, do, for, I, equals, 1, 200, etc. And if you want to know the full, or want to refresh your memory about pseudocode at any point, you can go to our course website, find it there, pseudocode reference. You can also play with pseudocode at a site called Scratch at MIT.edu, which I do recommend. video on that. Scratch. I'm going to show it to you. Okay. So this is a great site for instruction.
What is it? www scratch something or other?
It's scratch on my computer.
Tanya's the only one left there. She's working away. Some kid has gone
ahead.
So that effect's going on, the fire. And I clicked sunny and now one.
The rain didn't go away, but the sun came out.
Something. Yeah. Okay, all right, so
it should be hierarchical. Clouds coming first, then the lightning, then the rain, right?
Yeah, I don't know what happened. It worked fine when I
did get around it.
Okay.
He created a world. He created a world that doesn't work by our intuition.
There you go. No. Okay. So, that's Scratch. In our course, we also have a version of pseudocode that's plugin that's like you can play with it and assemble things using a kind of point and click interface. But that's in the context of a robot. You have a little robot that you can program using this point and click interface on the pseudocode.
Is
it
Starlogger?
Sorry?
Starlogger?
No. We design our own point and
click
interface.
Yeah.
There are other things like this, yes. There are other things. Okay,
when my kids were growing up, they actually could program physical Lego machines.
Yes, like still can. Mindstorm. Lego Mindstorm. Yeah.
So
when they
were first grade, they were ready to race.
Yeah. If you encounter an obstacle, it's on right.
Yeah.
That kind of stuff. So it's the same if then else kind of essential. Okay. So our business was this. Questions to think about for our next lecture, which Tanya wanted you to address next time. What class of computational tasks can be solved by RDE? How dependent is this class on the exact definition of pseudocode? So we define pseudocode in a certain way. How does this impact the kinds of problems that you can solve?
Can I go over what our exact definition of pseudocode is?
It's not so important. I can, you know, point to that.
I'm just wondering that in the context of a question, how dependent is this class on the exact definition?
Right, so I'm asking you to think about it, yeah. You know, because you think about, you know, Apple's released a new operating system, right? And it can do all this whiz-bang new stuff, which the old one couldn't, right? So somehow we are conditioned by marketing to think, okay, there's new innovation which can let you do more and more things. I'm asking you to think, you know, we had this very simple Mickey Mouse programming environment, very few primitives. How far is it, you know? I said, an algorithm is something you can express in pseudocode. You know, is that very limiting? And what about pseudocode 2.0 or 3.0? Will that give you a new set of algorithms? I want you to think about that. What do you think is that is the answer? Is there a pseudocode 2.0 out there? Probably not. Why? So when marketing folks tell you, here's this new G-Wiz gadget which can do all this stuff which the old one couldn't, what are they saying?
They probably wrote applications for it, made it faster.
It runs faster on the new chip, yeah.
New chip, and they probably have more callable functions.
Yeah.
More things are locked in. So, I mean, the speed of that last one was called a part.
Yeah.
Then you call the first part.
So, the library is much more.
Library is better. And the links probably to the library are quicker.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, so
it's a building block problem as opposed to the logic problem. I don't think that I'm not being a computer scientist, but the logic stays the same.
Logic is the same. Yeah. So
and that's like sort of a fundamental fact of.
But let's say aliens were implementing computers not in silicon logic, but some other way.
Then
you're saying all bets are off.
So here's an example.
Well, all of my bets are off.
But humans could conceivably implement a computer using other devices, right, besides silicon.
So here's an example. So when I was working on ZebraNet with Margaret Martinosi,
yeah,
we used the chips that were available,
yeah,
and we needed what the logic was is that the animal storage GPS points where it was, but the goal was for it to talk to you and get your data and store it in the global and get your data. If you gave it to him, it would get your data. So everything would come back. So there was, we had to partition the chip into two memories, and we were stuck by size how much data we could store, because this chip that we could buy off the shelf could only add and subtract. It couldn't multiply or divide. And that severely limited our ability to do things. Because not only do addition and subtraction, so it made it very kludgy. So the students that were the computer scientists were working really hard to optimize everything. But if they could do multiplication and division, they would have been faster, nicer. But they couldn't do that.
I think
so they had to substitute addition for multiplication
and
subtraction.
Multiplication wrong way.
So that took up a lot of memory, took a lot of time, took a lot of electricity.
Yeah.
Which wore our collars down.
But here I'm asking you to envision this. So the same task would still be done.
But it would be slower because you'd be losing some of your.
But I'm asking about, in principle, what set of computation tasks can be solved. Does that change? So if we invent a new form of computer which is not still going to be.
Yes, I guess. All of the sort of. And what would happen if you had a chip where it's looking at the people's site on the chip and store an arbitrarily large number of states that are just, you know, either on or off? I have no idea what available syntax.
Okay. Yeah, that's a fascinating model. Firstly, of course, it's not clear there's any continuum in nature.
Right.
Because
this teacher.
No, I mean, yeah, quantum mechanics says, you know, it's actually quantum. Okay, so the theories of the world actually suggest that the world is discrete.
But we do have analog. I mean, a lot of things are analog that you then digitize, right?
That's right. So, but they are analog up to four digits of precision.
Right.
So that can be done by scanning. So, okay, we'll return to that question. So for now, we're talking about creating new worlds inside the computer, simulation. And let me introduce it using a very simple example called Conway's Dream of Life. John Conway is a classical memorandum in mathematics. In the late 1960s, he invented this game. It's a game kind of like solitaire. You don't play with another person, you play by yourself. Actually, there's really no strategy in the game. It's really an ecosystem. So think of it as a grid where at each grid cell, there can be a credit, or the grid cell can be empty. And survival, so there are rules, the crater is evolved in the following way, the following are the rules. So if the crater has two or three neighbors, meaning it has a society, a viable society around it, two or three, it survives at the next step.
Can it be on the diagonal?
That's right. So the neighbors are three, and two, eight neighbors.
You have eight neighbors, and you need at least two.
At least two or three, not at least two or three. If the critter has one or fewer neighbors, it dies of loneliness. If it has more than three, it dies of overcrowding. It's too crowded, yeah, food source.
It has potential to be outdoor.
And birth, a new critter is born if the cell is currently empty, and exactly three neighboring cells are created.
If its cell is empty or a neighboring cell?
So, there's a cell here, that's empty, and if you have three critters in neighboring cells, then at the next step, a critter would be empty.
But how can where it is be empty?
No, I'm just saying, in this cell, there'll be a new critter born. There's no critter here right now.
Well, where is it? Where is the parent of the critter?
The parents are the three neighbors.
Oh, the parents are three neighbors. They each can give birth?
No, together. They give birth to this critter in itself.
And then they'll die?
No, they don't die.
But they would die if they were
down. Yeah. So the death is
by definition when it gives birth.
At every cell, in other words, at every cell of this ecosystem does the following at every step. You know, it evaluates the number of neighbors. If there's no cell in this, there's no critter in the cell right now, and there are exactly three neighbors which have critters, a new critter is born in the cell.
In an adjacent cell to any one of the three.
Anyone? No. There's a cell which we are looking at.
Right.
It's currently empty. If in the neighboring cells there are exactly three critters at this time, then the next step there will be a new critter born in the cell.
But there's many cells around the three that could have babies.
That's right.
So all of a sudden, bang.
So all of these cells are evaluating independently.
Right. So the three neighbors. But by definition then, that makes a fourth neighbor, someone has to die.
Only at the next step.
At the next step, exactly.
Next step, yeah.
Next step. Mm-hmm. Because it populates.
Not necessarily, but yeah.
It doesn't mean somebody has to die.
Well,
could.
It says if it's more than three.
Okay, so it's a little bit hard to visualize how this is going to evolve, so let's go to a... So here's a game of life.
Okay, so the only way in which you die is if force.
Yeah. Here, look at it, Catherine.
Okay, here's a game of life. So we'll see how these evolve. So this is called an exploder. I'll start it. This is how it evolves, these craters evolve, or this ecosystem. Called an explorer. It's just the system following these rules. Okay, that was one. lightweight spaceship. Okay? Okay, there's some special rules about the corners, so which I'm not discussing. Cost per glider gun. Just those three rules, okay? Shooting out these little babies, which go to the corner.
Which that guy?
Die
there. No. See, shooting out those bullets, babies, what do we call them? I don't know. That's why it's called a slider gun. Spaceship with
the
camera. Yeah. Like to show them the space. Based on just initial conditions.
Just different initial conditions.
Number of neighbors on the space.
Yeah, show them here.
Okay. Just a stable population, which takes the shit over and over again. Okay, so let's do a custom one. Clear. Let's do another one. Let's create one of our own.
We're gonna scroll to take.
Cross.
Is it
cross?
Oh, well, yeah. That's okay.
All right.
Oh, yeah.
Should be some
death.
Yeah, everybody died. You see? Did you see that? Yeah.
Why did everyone die?
There was
no.
How do you
unmute?
This
one
cross.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hey guys.
Yeah.
If you look at our screen, there's a game of life that's running much more sort of complex version of it. If you had 3D glasses, that would be in 3D, the whole thing would become right after this whole.
I don't think polarization.
So it's very simple rules, which are very similar to what you can describe it. Very local.
Yeah. Yeah. So there are all kinds of games like this. This one is.
You want to explain it? You can see.
Who wants to explain?
Okay.
It's Carrie. And actually, Carrie, one of the students in the course, who developed this one.
Okay, cool. Okay, so. So,
we can
all right,
sleep
what
we
need to do. So, what is the cost of that direction? Should we
read that?
Yeah.
What
happened here?
Okay.
Yes, you should
have. Oh, so we can see. Okay, yeah, that's more important than the
simple rule configuring common behavior, yeah. I guess I don't think that this crowd doesn't mean. So, in production AI, I guess that's what you study. Okay,
but the specific changes to the rules are also going to be important.
Right. Simple rule configuring
for two, four neighbors that can change everything
completely. And John Conway, the history of this is, he made it as a kind of solitaire puzzle. You would use like large chessboard kind of thing to do this and play with it. And he invented these rules because it seemed interesting. And here's this interesting story. It caught on, okay? So in the 1970s, computers, the personal computer became popular. Steve Jobs, and popular and hobbies could code it up, right? Very, very simple to code it up. And people would study, and you know, it was quite a fact. That's what people would do with their PCs at home. You know, there were no apps or Wi-Fi or anything. So people would play with these things, and people started discovering all kinds of patterns. And then, at some point, it was discovered that this is basically a computer. This ecosystem with these rules is a universal computer. You can implement any computation. What that means, we'll discuss in the next lecture. But this is a computer. So it's like one of these science fiction things, right? They say, okay, what is a computer, right? Created by who knows what, but you know, it's it's computing with the things that interact, like particle interact, computer, and the whole point of the computer and the part of the part of computer simulation matrix.
You can put values on those matrix so they can change.
Yeah,
it's
all
okay. All right, so discussion time. How would you write pseudocode that simulates the system? So obviously, you have to use an n binary array for the design n. And aij equals 1 means we create a little square and 0 means square n. At every step.
And then you just build those rules, those if rules.
Okay. Okay, and so.
Okay, so which one would you start with?
For each square on the array, you have to sum the values of all the neighbors.
So you have eight possibles, but if it's less, if it's two or three, it's one thing. If it's more than three, it's another thing. And if it's not or one, it's another thing. So you have the regions of where it means that you die, you go to zero, you make the cell zero. Or it survives.
But you have to be careful about how you update the arrays because you don't want things that go through n cells on the array in a single time step and you can't let your changes beginning with that time step
arrays. But that's an assumption.
No. You do need two arrays.
No, but I'm saying but the linearity, you could do it in real time, that you have that you start from left to right and it's changing forever as opposed to finish the whole thing then make the change.
Right. But the way I described it, there were generations. There were generations of critters. The current generation, you look at...
But biologically, that's not necessarily true.
That's correct.
Okay, but so that's an assumption you're putting in. That's a constraint and a rule that says you do all the computations, then...
So for the current generation...
Then you change everything.
Then you change it.
Okay. Okay, so that's a big assumption, but that's okay.
Okay. So pseudocode for each step is something like that. Do for I equals 1 to n, for j equals 1 to n.
So I is horizontal and j.
I is row, j is column.
Okay.
I guess you've all done math that, so you're familiar with this. Neighbors is the number of neighbors currently, so you sum up the a, I, j values for all the neighbors, I minus 1, j minus 1, etc.
Is your work command? If it's 2 or 3.
So, yeah, now if it's 2 or 3.
Then you live.
Then there's a neighbor. Then there's a critter. Okay, so you have a sequence of L's if the number of neighbors is 1 and.
1 you die, 1 you're going to go to 0. If it's 2 or 3, you survive and play the game again.
So I didn't put it all there, but
and
then it's what goes on.
It's greater than 3, you die too.
That's right. And then. At the end of that loop, you've done that, you copy, so you're putting these new values into a new array B, and then at the end you copy B into.
So that's the survival value, then comes the reproduction value, right? This is just who's going to be around them.
No, I'm assuming that those rules have...
Oh, you're going to do it.
Yeah, those orders.
You do all three of them, and then you transform.
That's right. So moral of the game of life, you guys came with it, a very simple local behavior can be complex global behavior. The other moral is that we can write simple computer programs to study this complex behavior. Because the rules are simple, you just code it up. Right, and that's the way you do all them. So other things that you can simulate, and people do simulate from here on this campus as well. Physics of snow crystals. How do snow crystals form? There's some simple physics. There's water vapor and particles of water, molecules of water floating around in the air. And once a crystal starts forming, molecules attach. Molecules of a certain geometry on the top right. There are two hydrogen atoms with an oxygen atom with a certain angle that's made between them. And those charges on these in the bond, and those charges are trapped. That physics is on the code. So you can do it, and you can predict what kind of crystals you want based on that physics. And those are examples.
So you can get lots of infinite shapes of snow crystals.
No, It's not infinite.
No, but you gotta fix them, but yeah, based on some rules. You
some very large number of crystals. Whereas in the game of life, you can get this infinite variety of behaviors. Similarly, twister or weather. How does weather prediction happen? Why can't we predict the weather much? Again, I have a sense that this crowd would know this much. So, how does weather prediction happen? Okay, so that's the reason for why you can't predict the weather. That's, yeah, that's one big reason. There are other reasons. But how does weather prediction happen? How do you think it will happen?
It's an algorithm based on the time step.
So you have a lot of observations. So that, would that, is that likely to work? So the, so you talk about like weather over a large area, right? Like the US and a little bit in the ocean, sorry, quite a bit, because ocean currents are quite. But instantaneous weather pattern right now. But you think you can match it to something in history?
Could we set the trajectory based on?
Right. Based on low pressure and high pressure, you could.
No, but your algorithm was you get this data, and you have a large data set of past, you know, what happened in the past, and you just match it, the closest match to the past, and then you, whatever happened then, you assume what happened. But that's never going to work for things like, you know, global warming, because we just don't have that data, right? Having your
vision.
Sorry?
That's
climate, yeah.
You go, go back to your ice crystals forming, right?
Yeah.
Your ice crystals. So you have a cell, and you ask the question, does that cell cool or not? And what's the function of the number of acres or not? And say locally you could build, is that water vapor going to stay as water vapor? Is it going to form rain? Is it going to form snow?
Yeah.
Right? And so you could do that there. And if you had any forces like high pressure or low pressure, they could slide.
Yeah.
They could move. And so you would build these cells, deal with each cell and see how the cells move. So,
so that's,
it's very complicated. Yeah, that's it. Yeah.
So twister or weather or anything, hurricane, trying to simulate, because it simulated hurricanes to see how they're going to develop. And each hurricane is different, so you really can't match it to a prior event and predict that way. So you simulate it like this.
So for example, we do not know in East Africa where we're going. No one has been able to predict whether it's going to get wetter
or drier with global climate change. So we know that it's going to warm. We know the Indian Ocean is going to warm. We know there's going to be more moisture in the air. But what no one can do with the Indian Ocean and the pressure in the Indian Ocean and the pressure in the Southern Atlantic, no one knows whether that water is going to just go up and down in the Indian Ocean or whether that water is going to move over the land and wet it. If it keeps going up and down, it's going to dry. And the models, Princeton, you know, GFDL cannot answer that question. They do not know enough about those two pressure systems to feel confident where that moisture is going to stand in the ocean and come over the land.
So here's the way to do it. Okay, this what the demo is saying. You divide a region into a grid, like a 3D grid. So for the game of life, you have a 2D grid. And you identify laws of physics for air, okay? So for instance, maybe your Stokes equation, which describe using the language of partial differential equations, how does a block of air move when there's a certain pressure, temperature, and velocity differential on it. And so if you have detailed enough data, you initialize it and update it according. So
you can tune the equations based on.
No, the equations don't change.
The parameters in the equations don't change.
The weightings. I think of like the most basic linear source, which is described. And then, so the law of physics doesn't change. And then, based on, you know, it's just like the game of life simulation. So there's a cell, there's a block of air there. You look at the neighboring cells, what the conditions are, and that tells you how. And then, so you just keep updating all the stuff. Okay, so that's roughly how it's done. And formally, it's just
So when you have different, but you often get 7 or 8 tracks of a hurricane.
Yeah, right.
Okay, and, you know, it goes this way one, another one goes over to the west. Then you're still using the same Adler-Stokes equation.
That's right.
But they're doing something different. The initial conditions are different. The strains are different.
Yeah, I'm guessing that for a hurricane,
some people.
Sanjeev Stokes is probably too fine-grained. This was just an example. Therefore, hurricane large blocks of air, there are probably other equations that they use, which are approximate.
Yeah, and that's
maybe Stokes.
That's where the errors.
Yeah, and that's where they get the errors and so on. But, so, like, you can't do this, you know, at the granularity of blocks of this size. You know, you're simulating an area of tens of thousands of miles. If you have blocks of this size, it's competition. They have larger blocks of air, and then those are not described in those.
Yeah.
There's probably some other equation. So formally, as a pseudocode, it's just a large for loop. Okay, do for I equals 1 to n, do for j equals 1 to n, do for k equals 1 to n. Update the state of grid I, j, k. Grid other than I, j, k. So just like we did
I, j, k.
And then there's a 4 every time, yeah. Mm-hmm. Keep repeating your order. Yeah, if you want to preserve what happened every time, otherwise you would just have a B and A as we did for the end, right? And just maintain it.
You'd erase it, you just would do the iteration like we did here as opposed to storing it.
So can you
look
in?
Well, but at some point,
So that depends, you know. So it's kind of solved as a continuous differential equation. You can't do it.
Differential equations are analytic solutions.
Very scientific. If you're really solving a differential, you know, you're using Navier Stokes or something, you know, you really need small elements. So probably the models of the Earth, even with really large chunks, much more coarse-grained. And I don't know exactly what equations it is. And probably those equations are not very exact. Maybe Stokes is.
So I think the important take-home point is you understand the updating and the iteration and the information. Because when we're working with Tanya's people in Africa, and you're saying, I want to know the distribution of the bird nests that we talked about last night, what would determine the optimal distribution of the bird, you know, how the birds build their nests, you're going to break it down into these simple rules based on information, whatever that is. We as biologists will talk about lots of different types of information. What we're going to have to do is say, that's too much. Let's strip it down to a few dimensions, a few variables, and then we'll figure out with them the rules that we think are important. Is it just the neighbor, or is it two neighbors down? There's a whole host of stuff that we have to understand to be able to talk to the code writers, right? So this is really valuable, just understanding the logic.
We're than code writers.
We're not going to write code.
Okay.
We object to the we object to the term code writers, though.
No. You know what I mean.
Object to the name.
Yeah, you data collectors. Hey.
Yeah, that's right. We object to that.
Other example, the simulation I already said, weather forecasting, protein folding, that's a big application in bioinformatics.
So Jim Murray has done these zebra stripes. I don't know if you've seen his paper that he just did. I mean, these are the Turing equations. But how you get these developmental patterns based on morphogens that diffuse, and when they intersect, that's what causes like the Y that occurs in the leg. It's very unnatural because it's usually up and down, it's not sideways. But you can create the patterns that zebras have, or the stripes on snakes, or the spots on leopards.
Do people know this? Is that right now the Turing work?
We're going to do this in our leopard.
Which leopard?
We just have master
birds.
Okay. I just wanted to mention, by the way, so Turing was known here as the father of morphogenesis, is also the father of pure science. And the biggest prize in pure science is called the Turing.
So I don't know if you know Jim Murray. Jim Murray's done a lot of
I don't know his
work. He's a theoretical biologist. And so he's retired, but he's here.
Okay.
So he's someone you might want to meet.
Okay.
He's done all this. He's written a nice review paper on this encyclopedia on Turing.
Yeah. So next lecture we'll talk about computer science work.
I will send out his paper to everybody because it's really interesting. Because it deals with creation of zebra stripes and spots.
Turing's paper, morphogenesis.
But Jim Murray's written about the sort of history of these ideas.
Us too. Send it to us too.
Very good. I will make a note to get Jim Murray's paper.
By the way, next year is Turing's birth centenary. There's a celebration here. Turing for the PhD. Animation, you know, computer animation, that's ubiquitous in movies these days, is done via simulation.
So those are repelling forces, right? The attractive forces that you're using there?
Where? In the protein folding?
In the protein folding.
I don't remember where I got this.
Right. Mm-hmm. That must be.
Yeah, I mean, I just.
So that's all the plus, you would say, the plus and minuses, right?
Oh, you mean, yeah.
Each other. Does it repel? Does it attract? And then once you change the composition, how does that change
it? It actually uses the whole energy minimization, and it talks about the whole side chain positioning for every possible type of molecule that can stick out from the backbone. How it interacts with every other one, and so then it tries to minimize the whole energy.
So that's key, Kanya. You want to follow on from that? So far, we haven't talked about minimizing anything or maximizing anything. So we have the local rule that would be repel or attract, but just oscillate, right? There's nothing that guarantees that you're going to adaptively form a shape that has a function. But if you said our criteria for success would be Gibbs free energy minimization, then that would be what you're comparing to, sort of like our rule of finding the lowest price perfume, you have a goal in mind, right? That was the goal. And so Tanya just threw that in, that it's not only the forces, but it has a goal to find this energy minimization, which is what some of the projects we did last time was, and we weren't sure as biologists what mattered most to those distribution and nest. Was it wind? Was it temperature? And we partly were doing the visualization under different conditions to see if the pattern that was simulated actually matched the pattern that we saw. That would tell us something about which of those possible conflicting goals drove the pattern.
Right.
So you could have
protein.
Energy minimization could be one. Speed or stability, speed of arriving at the confirmation could be another. Stability, when it's locked in with something, is another, and it's not energy minimization. So you could have three or four different criteria using the same rules.
Right, we talked last time, we talked about finding shortest path and thinking and figuring, comparing what the optimal shortest path in general in a network of roads versus from point A to point B versus that's if you have the whole map view of the map versus if you have only limited sort of memory of your neighborhood, what would be, how would you find the shortest path? And so comparing the optimum that the algorithm finds to say what you observe an animal do, and then you can infer from that how much memory the animal might have of the landscape by how it looks for the shortest path.
Right. You could build hypothetical animals with different memory reaches and see at what point you get realism versus not.
Right.
So when I was a kid, when I was an undergraduate, we had to do the extended problem that we had to do was, you have a minibus, it's got to pick up 15 people, how do you go through town to minimize the time that the minibus spends? That was a prim network, so what was the connections? So you would deduce the prim network based on that. And that's sort of an algorithm that we used to use in phylogeny. How do you build a minimum tree to account for all the species? The minimum number of connections. So that fits in with this rule of parsimony, which is a criteria, but not necessarily the right criteria.
So I wanted to, bigger question, simulation. So we saw simulation. You can now step back and ask a bigger question, right? Can computer simulation be replaced by a theory of weather, a theory of tone? So we have Newton's laws of motion, which predicts, if I see this slide and I know the coefficient of friction, how far that goes, and so on. Can the theory of weather plug in the few variables, plug in something, create a how it's going to evolve, the next time we do a theory of tornadoes. Or, less ambitious, is there a theory that answers this type of problem, given a starting configuration in the game of life? Like one of those spider or whatever we saw. The output is, yes, if the cell at position 100, 100 is ever occupied by a critter, otherwise not. Right? Give as an input to this theory the initial configuration. And then ask the question, will the cell numbered 100, 100, 100 to 100 column ever get occupied? So, right, so if you want to, you can't answer this by simulation.
Okay, you have to have, how many starting conditions?
No, one starting.
Oh, one starting.
But for a fixed starting, I give you as an input. Then what?
There's no stochasticity issue, it's totally deterministic. You should be able to figure it out.
How many? How would you work back with that? Because you don't know about the rest of
the infinite configurations that include.
You don't know what the configuration was that gave you one of those critters being in 100. There could be many different. You saw in the expanding one, it was slowly expanding, and there were more critters. So that was a population that was leaving a void and getting slightly larger. And others, it was a steady state number. They kept hitting absorbing boundaries, and that slider gun looked like it was just a fixed number of individuals going up and then coming down. And then. So you wouldn't be 100%.
But I don't know what probability means. That's, I don't know how much formal probability theory you study, but it's not clear what that means.
Because
what's the space in which you think probability?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes. In some cases, like we saw this. In
some cases, yeah. In which you find that it quickly occupies that square.
So Bob May did a lot of these games at Hawk Dove and same with Simon Levin. And with no stochasticity, they became what we used to call Persian rugs. They got to a fixed point, they were done. They got to their end point, they froze, right?
This was Game of Life?
No. It was a Hawk Dove game, certainly. Okay. But it was another game. But again, if you can answer the question, would red, which meant the hawk, ever be in space 100? Well, in that game, the answer was yes. You knew you could find out yes or no, because once it froze, then you knew the answer, right? It took so many time steps and it froze.
And it was guaranteed to freeze.
It was guaranteed to freeze with no stochasticity. As soon as you added stochasticity, a random death that wasn't programmed, then you just took a certain cell and said, I'm going to just off it, not by the rules, but it was going to randomly off it. Then you never could, you never got frozen.
What?
I wanted to look on Wikipedia, but I don't have internet.
But the question I'm asking you to think about is, you cannot conceive, and you said this already, you cannot conceive of a way to predict this. Whether or not the cell at position 100 is evolved.
How many of you have?
Yeah, you run the simulation, but then there's a problem that if the simulation doesn't dominate, and it doesn't give an answer, then you prove that it's never going to happen?
Yeah, that's right.
So
you never prove it's never going to happen.
So it's a different characterization of entropy.
So, you know, the question is there a simple theory that answers the question?
It's connecting.
You input, you know, the numbers, you know, the starting configuration is some and crank some equations, and then gets an answer.
Imagine it comes to a limit. It's
totally getting rid of the
technology. You know, that you can't.
But that's why I alluded to that earlier, that this is a universal computer. Game of Life is a universal computer. But we talk about this.
So
about simulation, you know, there's some questions you can answer like simulation.
About
it's not clear that there's necessarily, even for very simple systems, a closed form solution.
Because when we talk about we don't decide
there's a philosophical question, what's definite a closed form, but I would, one, the answer that Turing's definition of his experience was that is a closed form solution. I have maybe something that can program.
Is this question equivalent to asking whether there's whether the simulation is
crashing? Not just simulation, but any
right.
You know, whether this piece of software will ever crash.
Right.
You know, those things actually cannot be determined by closed theory of simulation. Sort of equivalent.
So, in that setting.
Okay, peeking ahead, a computer can simulate any other computer, for instance, on a Mac, you can buy the simulator program, which can be easy. We see implications of this as well. And as already mentioned, Game of Life is actually a computer.
And so that was.
But that actually we won't prove it.
No, so the characterization of P was that they have
We can just stop here. I see that there was some interest in efficiency and consulting.
The last quickly, I have a thought about how it is faster. I'm not sure if it is.
Okay, efficiency. Yeah, we can talk about it.
What if at the first step, I calculated it, say, all the things that I have.
I'm going to quote
something. I just scanned it quickly and find those that are above me, those that are below me.
Gotcha. And so that's
then,
the setup that he introduced.
Then if I were to travel on MS code, I'd only have to, do it the same number n times. But each time,
yeah, and
I only
so
have
that was
to scan,
the time,
you know, some
sort of
number less than n elements to do it. So it seems like it would yield potentially a lot faster.
You had to compute the mean, which is not a
well,
but mean is just
n is quick. It's one scan through.
It's an excellent algorithm. Excellent algorithm. But there's a problem with
it. So then, if I wanted to, you know, if it were big enough to make this relevant, I could actually then take that step down on my tabs.
You could keep doing it.
Yeah.
So it's called divide and conquer. You're trying to divide your n numbers into two sets. And you know that these are always bigger than the mean and these are smaller than the mean. And so you can now. Independently,
do that again? So you decide it again?
You can do that again. It'll be between the two.
It's fine that you get down to the last one.
Right.
One small one.
Size one and then do it. That's actually a great idea. The problem is
3 years to fix the problem.
Okay, remember that. So how many, what fraction of the American population gets, earns more than?
A very small fraction.
Okay, so
you
could
be
anybody.
I
couldn't figure out if I, it seemed far or less efficient to calculate.
Median's hard to calculate.
Than to calculate the
means. Median's hard, exactly.
That was what I said.
That's right. Excellent. So you're anticipating all the issues. So calculating the mean is easy, right? You just take the sum of numbers and take them, divide by n.
The median's hard.
Median, you want to do. So if you get a median, then you actually divide it into two equal halves, and then you're really making progress.
But can you do that without solving the problem first?
So the median
is a classic algorithm from 1973. You can find the median in time, which is order n. So just like the mean, you know, you do n solutions and divide by n.
So you can still find the median.
Median order n.
You can do it just as fast as the mean.
Up to a constant factor. 5 or something.
Wow. Okay. Sure. So the mean would help the zoom if the one so skewed.
Right. So the approximation for the TSP.
Given that you can count.
If you have skewed,
median,
you're in trouble. You have a long tail.
So median is
better. Pick up 15 people, right?
Median, but gives you half and half, so that's why it's reducing it down.
Yeah, we're saying
the median, which is the median space.
5
is
probably.
How do you do the median quickly?
Arbitrary close to the optimal solution.
Okay. So since you want to know.
This is efficiency now, right?
Yes.
So
you want to see why it's 5.
Okay.
The idea is you divide the number into groups of size 10. Okay. So that's 10 over 10 groups.
You do each 10.
Okay. Now within those 10, you find mean.
Close up to PC.
So this may not come out to 5 now. So within each you find median. So that's clearly some constant number of operations. Right? You find median of 10 elements. Maybe it takes 50 operations. There's some constant. Now among those medians you compute the median. So that's n over 10 medians. You compute the median. Using the same algorithm.
So you have a median and the grand median, the grand 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 median. Yeah.
No, just that. Now you have a median of the n over 10 medians. Now you partition according to that. Okay? Now, we know that in the n over 10 groups, we took the median of the medians, right? So we know that for n over 20 of the groups, the lower half of those groups is less than this element. And we know that in n over 10 of the groups, the upper half is more than this. So we know that each side has at least n over 20 times 5, which is n over 10 elements. So you haven't had a completely 50-50 split, but you've got about 10, yeah, 90-10 split. It's not worse than 90-10. And now, here it goes. So why is it linear time? This was the first algorithm I saw in my algorithm course, and it was just completely transfixed. I happen to be for a living, so it's
okay. Yeah, that's great. So Tanya.
Yes.
What's happening next week? You have us both down for lecturing. Is that right?
Yeah. So I just want to make a comment. Dan, you said that one of the first algorithms you saw was this thing of how to take some number, a bus that has to distribute some people.
Minimize the total distance, yeah.
To minimize the total distance. That's actually a traveling salesman problem. So you have to visit a whole bunch of locations and you have to minimize the total distance traveled. Traveling salesman problem, which you have this traveling salesman and has to sell stuff and has to visit houses in the shortest possible route. And the interesting connection that, so this problem is one of those computationally intractable, provably computationally intractable problems, very, very hard computational problems. And for a particular version of it, which if you have it in the Euclidean space, which your version was, because it's a bus traveling in this real world, you can get as close as you, arbitrarily close to the optimal solution using a series of very specialized sort of algorithm, and the discovery of that type of approximation to the optimal length, Sanjeev Arora received his second Gödel Prize for discovering that particular algorithm. Yeah, so that's kind of the interesting connection.
Yeah. We'll talk about efficiency next time. Oh, when will I come next time?
Okay. Yeah.
So what, you want me to talk about game theory next time?
Yeah, so I thought next time we're going to split, and we're going to split, we have to figure out how, because we'll need this room for you to lecture to us about evolutionary game theory and sort of population dynamics.
And these guys know that, so they can go in Brian's room.
Right.
We can set you up to present Brian's lab.
Right.
So you can see without me. So I will talk to you guys in this room, just me.
Right.
Well, I'll set you up.
Well, yeah, we won't see you, Sanjeev. We won't see what you're going to be doing to these guys, but Dan is going to be talking to the computer scientists about population dynamics and the evolutionary game theory and competition and things like that.
Okay.
You get to this then.
Okay. Yeah, I would have loved to see
them. Okay. But okay, so I'll talk to them more or less on hot dogs and on other sorts of games we didn't talk about last night. It's build up the logic of frequency dependence.
Sanjeev.
Yeah.
I mean, you said you would have liked to see that. We can try to, you know, do this the second time of what computers cannot do in at a different time.
Yeah, we don't have to, you know,
these guys don't need to hear it, because you guys didn't need to hear this, right? So they're not going to want to hear it again. So let me talk to you guys. We can get together over lunch.
Yeah,
fill him in, he'll fill me in on the efficiency, okay? We'll head over lunch.
Yeah. Okay, all right.
Real fast, okay? Okay? Mm-hmm. But you guys will get the efficiency lecture, and I'll do the game theory lecture, okay?
Okay, great.
All right, and so I can do the game theory lecture the same way that he's done it with PowerPoint slides, it looks like. I can project that we can talk.
Yeah.
Or I can do it on the blackboard.
We can't see the blackboard.
Okay, I'll do it as a PowerPoint.
If you want to do it on the blackboard, then you can do it, but you'll
have
to...
I moved the picture.
You can have the best board boards. If you can get a tablet. No, not a tablet computer.
I mean, it's right on it.
Yeah, just to connect to this tablet.
Okay, I'll do something.
Or you can move the camera closer to the board. That way we can see what's
going on. Okay, no problem.
Sanjeev, thank you very much. That was actually very interesting.
That was very good.
Yeah.